Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Vishnu Sahasranam playlist. We are here again after another week, and today I am very excited because we are going to start with Bhishma Pitama. He is going to start the Vishnu Sahasranam, the thousand names, and he has heard the questions from Yudhishthir Maharaj. Kimekam devatam loke kimva pekam parayanam stuvanta kam kam achantam. प्राप्नि उर्माणम आशुभम को धर्म सर्व धर्माणाम भवतो परमो मतः किम जपन मुच्यते जंतु जन्म संसार बंधनात्. सो दीज आर द क्वेश्चंस व्हिच ही हैड आस्क्ड एज वी हैड डिस्कस्ड इन आवर प्रीवियस वीडियो. सो इफ यू हैव नॉट वॉच्ड द प्रीवियस वीडियोस देन प्लीज वॉच, इट्स इन दिस प्लेलिस्ट इटसेल्फ. ओके, विष्णु सहस्त्रनाम प्लेलिस्ट. And finally, there you go. We are going to start now with Shri Bhishma Uvacha. Okay. So in the scriptures, you will always find this word, Uvacha. Okay. Uvacha means the person is speaking. Okay. And sometimes you will also find Uchuhu. There is another word. Okay. So especially if you read the Srimad Bhagavatam, where there is this story of Ajamil in the sixth canto. So there the Yamadutas are talking to Yamraj. So there it is said Uchuhu. Okay. So either ways, this refers to somebody who is speaking. Okay. So in Bhagavad Gita, it's mentioned Shri Bhagavan Vacha. So Shri Bhagavan, who is Lord Krishna, is speaking. Okay. So that's the meaning of this Shri Bhishma Uvacha. Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam Stuvan Nama Sahasrena Purusha Satatottitaha. Bhishma said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the controller of all moving and non-moving beings within the universe. Jagat Prabhu means the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Deva Devam, who is Deva Devam? Deva means Deva is like Deva Deva means he's like the Deva of the Devas also. Okay, so here the second Devam, Deva Devam, the second word Devam refers to the Devatas. Okay, like the Devatas headed by Brahma, Shiva, Indra, Varuna, and then Surya, Agni, and all these are Devatas. So Deva Deva means Jagat Prabhum. Jagat means the universe. Prabhu means God himself. Jagat Prabhu means he is the Lord of the entire universe. And Deva Devam, he is the Devata of the Devas also. So generally these Devatas are always worshipped by the human beings. Okay. For n number of reasons, religious or spiritual or whatever you want to call it. But he is the one who, Jagat Prabhu is the one who is worshipped by even the Devatas. Okay. So there are many other references to this similar sloka in the scriptures. Okay. One very famous sloka which comes to my mind is Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Maruta Stunvanti Divyai Stavai. So this sloka is very famous, and this is a very beautiful sloka. Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Maruta Stunvanti Divyai Stavai. Yam means Yamraj. Brahma is Brahmaji. Yam Brahma Varun. Varuna is the god of the seas, water. Okay. Yam Brahma Varun Indra. Indra means Indra. Indra is the king of the heavens. He is known as he is known as Devaraj sometimes, Devaraj Indra. Yam Brahma Varun Indra Rudra. Rudra is Shiva himself, Lord Shiva. And Maruta. Maruts are also the wind gods actually. Alright. And they are actually, they are in one way, they are brothers of Indra actually. Actually, not literally, but that's a long story. How the Maruts are Indra's brothers actually. Yam Brahma Varun Indra Rudra Maruta Stunvanti Divyai Stavai. Stunvanti Divyai Stavai means they are always doing stuti. What kind of stuti? Divyai, which means divine chants. They are chanting divine hymns. Okay. For whom? For for whom are they chanting? Alright, so Yasyantam Navidusura Surgana Devaya Tasmai Namaha. So this is they are doing stuti for Lord Vishnu actually. Okay. Vedai Samaga, which means the Yasyantam Navidusura Surgana, which means the Suras, the Devatas, they also cannot fathom, even they cannot understand Lord Vishnu. Okay, so they are doing stuti for Lord Vishnu actually. This is one of the very beautiful slokas. Okay. So here also the same thing is referred. Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam. Anantam means one who is endless actually. Okay. Purushottamam. Purushottam, best of the beings actually. He is the controller of all moving and non-moving beings. Jagat. Jagat means moving and non-moving. Because anything in this world is either moving or non-moving. And he is the worshipable master of all the demigods. Deva Devam. He is the Deva of all the Devatas. His transcendental forms and qualities are unlimited. Anantam Purushottamam. So, Anantam means one who is endless, but one whose forms, transcendental forms and qualities, Rupa, Guna, Leela, these three things are also unlimited. Okay. And he is the best of persons. Okay. This word Purushottam is very frequently used. So we also have the Purusha Sukta prayers. Then we have Vishnu. Then we have Krishna. Then we have Ram. So Lord Ram is Maryada Purushottam. So he sets example for human beings, okay, especially for human beings, how a human being should lead his or her life. That is what is the prime objective of Lord Ram's incarnation. How should an ideal human being be? Okay, and then we have Vishnu, who is known as Leela Purushottam. So Lord Ram is Maryada Purushottam and Vishnu is Leela Purushottam because he takes a lot of avatars and does so many leelas. Okay, and Ram is one of the avatars, of course, of Vishnu. And then we have Krishna. Krishna is Purna Purushottam actually. So Krishna is Leela Purushottam and he is also Maryada Purushottam. So all the traits of Ram you will also find in Krishna. Okay, but he sets a higher standard actually. Okay, higher means Lord Ram's incarnation teaches us how a human being should behave. But Krishna's incarnation doesn't teach that. Krishna's incarnation teaches that also, Maryada Purushottam, and much more, how God is actually. Okay, so if you see the differences, if you see the incarnations, they are very different. So for example, Lord Ram did not do any, he did, but you won't find much superhuman activities during the Ramayana. Okay, superhuman means he means that he behaved like a very ordinary human being. So for example, when he wanted to cross the Lanka, cross the ocean and go to Lanka, then he was sitting and doing puja for this Samudra Dev. Okay, so that Samudra Dev will give him the way. Okay, for 2 days, 3 days, for a long time he did, and when he did not give, then he took out a Brahmastra and he was about to discharge the Brahmastra and dry up the entire ocean actually. Okay, then Samudra Dev came out. So that's what Lord Ram's life teaches, that ideally a human being should follow all the standard Vedic procedures. Okay, just because you are some powerful or you are rich or you are affluent, it doesn't mean that you should just bypass all authority, bypass all standards. Okay, that's not recommended. So that is what Lord Ram teaches. But if you see Krishna's life, he does a lot of superhuman activities which normal human beings cannot do. So for example, he lifts the Govardhan Parvat. Okay, so and then he goes to Samyamnipuri, and from there he brings the sons of his guru Sandipani Muni. Okay, because they had performed some sins and they had left their bodies. And then Sandipani Muni's wife, Krishna Balaram's Guru Mata, she told Sandipani Muni that Krishna is God himself, so you should not ask some petty thing because that will humiliate him and his reputation will go down. So ask something which nobody has ever done. Okay, ask him to bring back our children from Yamloka actually. Okay, Sayamnipuri. So then Krishna Balaram goes and brings back the sons of Sandipani Muni. Okay, then he leaves Govardhan Parvat and he does so many. I mean, when Jayadrath was supposed to be killed, he again somehow he does it. All right, so therefore he is known as Purna Purushottam. Okay, so therefore it is said here his transcendental forms and qualities are unlimited. Okay, so Krishna has 64 qualities. Okay, so we'll discuss about it some other time. But they are like unlimited, they are all variegated, and there's a lot of there's as the Brahma Samhita says, you know, nava yovanamcha means Krishna's form in the spiritual world is nava yovana, means it's always ever youthful. Yovan means youth, nava yovana means ever youthful. And it is also said, you know, shyamam tribhanga lalita nyapta prakasham. This is also from the Brahma Samhita, that his form, although it is eternally youthful, but it's becoming more and more attractive day by day. So that's contradictory, that how somebody is the most beautiful, but how can the most beautiful become more and more beautiful every day? Doesn't fit to our human brain, right? But yeah, that's how Krishna is inconceivable. Okay, so here it said he is the worshipable master of all the demigods. So Bhishma is very intelligent here, you see. He's not just speaking some philosophy here, or he's not just cooking up things from his own. He's giving reference in various levels, actually. So he says Jagat Prabhum. Okay, so that means he says he's the one about whom I'm going to mention is the controller of all that exists. Okay, Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. There's another shloka which says this. Then he says Deva Deva means he is worshipped even by the devatas. Okay, Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Maruta Stunvanti Divyaistavai. Then he says Anantam means his Anantam Purushottam. Anantam means his qualities and forms, they are unlimited. Okay, so the Vishnu forms, they are unlimited actually. And their differentiation is done by, so Vishnu has four hands and he has the Shankha Chakra Gada Padma, about which we discussed in the previous in the second video, I guess, of this playlist. So in that we discussed about what actually this is, okay, what these four things represent. And apart from that, these things, they keep changing. Changing means sometimes in one Vishnu form, one of the forms have conch here, and another form will have the Shankha here, another will have the Gada, another will have the Padma here, then another will have it here. Okay, so based on that difference, there are like unlimited Vishnu forms. Okay, so and their leelas are different, and it's like it's endless basically. All right, so although you may think that okay, 4 into 4 into 4 into 4 or whatever, it's a limited number, but this is just one categorization which I give. So like that, there are many categories. All right, so therefore Bhishma is speaking at different levels, you can see. So first he speaks from this material realm, then he speaks about worship, Deva Devam, then he speaks about qualities. Okay, so these things are re-instantiating the fact, the reason why he is going to speak about this person. Okay, Purushottamam, and he is the best of persons. Stuvan nama sahasrena purushas satatothitaha. One should always enthusiastically glorify him. Stuvan nama sahasrena, by chanting the Vishnu sahasrana. Alright. One should always enthusiastically glorify him by chanting the Vishnu Sahasranam. Alright, Stuvan Nama Sahasrena. Nama means name, Sahasrena means thousand. Purushas Satatothitaha. Alright, so therefore, now he starts speaking again. Tameva Charthyam Nityam Bhaktya Purusham Avyayam Dhyayam Stuvam Namasyamscha Yajamanas Tameva Cha. With great faith, the devotee should worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna, whose forms, qualities, opulences, and pastimes are all eternal and transcendental. The devotee should glorify him, continually meditate on his transcendental form, and offer obeisances by bowing down before him. Wow, beautiful. This is beautiful, really beautiful. Tameva charthyam nityam. With great faith, the devotee should worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna. Nityam, okay, nityam means every day, all time. So even Srimad Bhagavatam says, you know, nityam Bhagavat Sevaya, which means many times people attend these Bhagavat Saptas in India, which means once 1 week out of the 52 weeks in a year, they will leave everything else and they will come and listen to Srimad Bhagavatam from some speaker. Okay. Now, that is very good. It's not bad. But Bhagavatam doesn't say one for 1 week. Okay. It says Nityam Bhagavat Sevaya, which means Srimad Bhagavatam should be read every day. Alright, so Bhishma is also speaking the same thing here. Tameva charthyam nityam. Okay. Bhaktya purusham avyayam. Alright. Lord Krishna, whose qualities, form, opulences and pastimes are all eternal. Dhyayam stuvam namasyam scha. Dhyayam means to do dhyan. Okay. Dhyan means to meditate or to contemplate. Okay. So, so many times people tell me that they try to do meditation. Meditation means silent meditation. Just closing your eyes and sitting in a mudra and posture and position and asana and then not doing anything. But the thing is, in Kali Yuga, we cannot do that because Kali Yuga means manda sumanda matayo. The mind is always disturbed. You can observe your mind. I can observe myself when I do meditation in the morning. Or when I chant mantras in the morning, and this is true with everybody, you know, the mind is so agitated, it's always disturbed. Manda sumanda matayo, manda bhagya upadrita. That sloka is there in the Bhagavatam. So, in Kali Yuga, we cannot do silent meditation. It is next to impossible. It's very difficult. So, Bhishma is telling, Stuva nama sahasrena purusha satatothitaha. Jagat prabhum deva devam anantam purushottamam. Okay. So, then he says, Dhyayam stuvam namasyam scha. So that means we should do dhyan of this great personality. Okay. So we can, when we are doing dhyan, we can meditate on the pastimes of Lord Vishnu and his different avatars. Okay. So starting from, you can take any avatar which is, which you connect more to. Okay. You can take Matsya avatar, you can take Varaha avatar, you can take Vaman avatar, you can take Narsingh avatar, you can take Ram, you can take Krishna, whichever incarnation you are most inspired by, you can take that. Okay. And this this is very crucial actually, because once I was attending a lecture, there one spiritual personality, a very big guru, he was telling the biggest crisis in this world. What is the biggest crisis in this world? It is not poverty, it is not lack of education, it's not lack of manpower, it's not overpopulation, it is not a lack of anything actually, except the fact that the biggest, this is huge. He said that it is a lack of a satisfying object of thought. So many times people tell me that when they are idle, or their mind is just going haywire, you know, it's like they are thinking of 10 different things. Their mind is going here, mind is going there. Okay. So there is no satisfying object of thought for people. So there is, if you look at the TV, you know, there is like, there's this negativity going on. Okay. This country is attacking that country. This state is blaming the other state. This political party is fighting with that political party. There is anger, there is hatred, there is dissension everywhere. Okay. So the biggest crisis, he said, is the lack of a satisfying object of thought. So therefore, Bhishma is telling here, Dhyayam stuvam namasyamscha yajamanas tamevacha. Okay. The devotee should glorify him, continually meditate. Okay. Dhyayam stuvam namasyamscha. On his transcendental form and offer obeisances by bowing down before him. Alright. So, this sloka actually is very, very, very important, because this sloka actually tells you how should your mood be during the Vishnu Sahasranam? Okay, these two shlokas actually. Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam Stuvam Nama Sahasrena Purushas Satatottitaha. So many times you may wonder why Bhishma is speaking about Krishna. Okay, why is he not speaking of somebody else? So these two shlokas actually answer. Okay, he is Jagat Prabhu, he is Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam. All right. So therefore, these two shlokas, they set the base for the Vishnu Sahasranam. Okay, the earlier shlokas were questions from Yudhishthir and invocations, prayers to the different rishis, great sages. Okay, but these two shlokas actually started by Bhishma Pitama. They will prepare you for the Vishnu Sahasranam, although it has already started. Okay, but the thing is, it's not of much use if you just read it like this. Okay, so you should understand the meaning and then you should do dhyan, which means the way we are doing now. What we are doing is we are doing one shloka and we are trying to understand the meaning. Okay, so by this what happens, we are actually contemplating. Now when I was telling you about the different forms of Lord Vishnu, so by that you are actually contemplating, right? When you are hearing, how does a man look when he has four hands, you know, with four different things? So there are different permutations and combinations actually. So the thing is, this is how exactly you should read actually. Okay, and I have the Bhagavad Gita playlist, you can watch those videos also. I have Srimad Bhagavata playlist. Okay, they will help you to be more absorbed during the Vishnu Sahasranam. Okay, otherwise you might just read or just recite it artificially as a ritual. This is what has happened in India. You know, people, I know so many people, they know Vishnu Sahasranam and they like to recite it. It's very good. But if you ask them, are you aware of the meaning? Okay. So now sometimes people say that, oh, the feeling is more important, meaning is not important. No, it's not like that. Feeling is there. Feeling is important. I'm not saying feeling is the ultimate goal. Okay. But the thing is, if you are aware of the meaning also, then what happens, it becomes easier for you to get that feeling. Okay, so now suppose somebody is just reading Vishnu Sahasranam, but he doesn't know the meaning. But now if he knows, you know, Jagat Prabhum Deva Devam Anantam Purushottamam, oh, the Suras, the Devatas, Yam, Brahma, Varun, Indra, Rudra, Marutas, they are also chanting his glory. So therefore, he must be a very great personality. So therefore, I must also do it. So it becomes easier for you to be in a mood of respect and reverence for Lord Vishnu. All right. So therefore, it's very crucial that you understand the meaning. Okay. So without understanding the meaning, we should not read things. Okay. And therefore, today we will end it here. So as I said, the biggest crisis is a lack of satisfying object of thought. So instead of thinking of regarding all the garbage of this world, you know, of money, opposite sex, we can actually contemplate on Lord Vishnu and these shlokas. You know, imagine how Bhishma was in that arrow bed, and then he was speaking. All right, so imagine his situation. Even then, he is speaking like this. Okay. So therefore, in the next video, we will continue with the next shlokas. I'll just read it. Anadi nidhanam Vishnum sarva loka maheshwaram. There you go. The word Vishnu appears finally. Okay. Sarva loka maheshwaram. Lokadhyaksham stuvam nityam. Sarva dukkhati go bhavet. All right. And then we have some commentaries from one of the great acharyas. His name is Baldev Vidyabhushan. All right. So there he gives glorification of the word Hari, all right? If one chants the two syllables Hari even once, he becomes free from all material bondage. So we'll read the shlokas later, but I'm just reading the meaning. O best of the Bhrigu dynasty, if one even once speaks the holy name of Lord Krishna, either with faith or even casually or with contempt, the holy name will liberate that chanter from all material bondage. Okay, so these two shlokas are given by Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan. He is a very great acharya in the Gaudiya Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya, and he has cited these two shlokas in addition to that shloka. Okay, Anadi Nidhanam Vishnum. All right.
So beautiful shlokas are waiting. So we will continue in the next video. All right. So there you go. Thank you very much for your patience. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who is interested to keep his mind occupied with good thoughts. All right. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your horoscope, you can always go down to the description section of my videos. Okay. And yes, if you want to watch the Bhagavad Gita videos, you can find it here. All right. Here or here. I don't know where YouTube places it. All right. Thank you very much and see you soon.